Item 1, is the any declarations of interest of any members or officers, any items on the agenda, Lesley?
Just as a trustee of fire support, this work in respect of any service or agreements or any money to pay to them, and there is reference made in the assets in relation to vehicles, so it's my personal interest.
Exactly the same for me, Dave.
We did receive an email about interest, if there's interest in anybody's own properties, that's been dealt with. I requested that all members' names and addresses be declared as if you're interested for the reasons to take part in the budget making process. Okay?
Great. That in essence was it, to make sure that the exemption was in place.
So. Yeah. So that's there. Okay. Any matters of urgency? Item 8, which is an exempt item, which was sent out. All members should have received that paperwork. So I get to item 5, item 8 on the agenda. Obviously, we'll have to exclude all the press and public. Okay. Item 2 is the notes from the previous meeting. They agreed?
Agreed, John.
Thank you. Item 3 is the asset management plan, pages 58 to 96.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members approve the asset management plans for estates, which is at Appendix A, ICT, which is at Appendix B, and transport, which is at Appendix C. The asset management plans set out the strategic goals for each of the asset portfolios. The underlying principle in us developing the asset management plans is to ensure that each asset delivers benefit to the authority through supporting the way in which we deliver our services. Paragraph 9 on page 16, the point is made that as our staff numbers continue to fall, it becomes ever more important that our physical assets support the most efficient and effective ways of working possible. Paragraph 10 of the report identifies that the asset management plan should be considered in conjunction with the capital programme, which should be asked to approve in the budget report later on in the agenda. An overview of the capital budget is provided at Appendix D of this report. I'll pause at that, Chair, and take up questions if members have any. Thanks.
Thanks. Any questions or comments on members?
Yes, Chair, just on page 28, under section 5, bullet points 4 towards the bottom of the page, annual portable appliance testing. Just to ask a question, is this something that we do in-house or do we farm it out? Because I haven't worked for a small charity in the past, every portable item had to be tested every year, and it was something like 93 pence, if I remember, and that's going back to 2001. And I'm wondering whether or not there's any mileage in us doing it in-house if we don't do it, which may incur saving, because if we look across the whole estate, we must have literally thousands upon thousands of portable appliances that need to be annually tested.
Previously, prior to the outsource of the FM contract, we had an individual as part of our state's team that undertook that testing and the way you described. But with the outsource now, that's picked up under that. In essence, it's the same person, but it's picked up under the outsource.
Item 4 is the final plan to review 2015-16, April to December 2015.
Thanks, Chair. Members have previously received reports on the authority's financial position for quarter 1 and quarter 2. This report updates members on the authority's financial position up to the 31st of December. The report covers an update on the budget reserves position, a review of Treasury Management Strategy, progress of the internal audit plan, and finally, some financial process performance indicators. Paragraph 6 to 10 on page 99 to 101 confirms that the revenue budget remains unchanged at 62.169 million, and all budget saving options planned for 2015-16 have been actioned. Table B on page 101 summarises the forecast for the year-end revenue position, which indicates a small unfavourable variance of around 1% or £650,000. This has come about as a result of employee and supplies expenditure savings being slightly ahead of those anticipated and a much small saving on the price inflation provision. Paragraphs 11 to 13 on pages 102 to 103 outlines the movements on the approved capital programme, and table C on the report on page 102 summarises these movements, being the inclusion of the new St Helens Community Fire Station at £5.3 million and the implementation of the changes identified in the asset management plans already considered on today's agenda that have rephased £4.5 million of planned expend from 15-16 into future years and reduced spend by £2.3 million and an equivalent reduction on the borrowing requirement. Paragraph 15 on page 103 recommends using the forecast £650,000 revenue saving to increase the capital investment reserve in light of the future station merger investment programme and to minimise future borrowing. Paragraphs 16 to 21, pages 103 to 106, confirm that the Treasury management strategy has remained consistent with the approved strategy. The authority held £21.8 million of investments as at the 31st December 2015, and this reflected the £6 million of unapplied government capital grants that will be spent as and when the station major programme starts to construct the stations, and that the pension grant monies required to deliver pension payments until the end of the year have been fully committed, and the level of unapplied reserves at that point in time. No new loans have been taken out in the year so far, or no new loans are expected to be taken out in the remainder of the year. As per paragraph 22 on page 106, most of the internal audit work is currently underway, and the audit subcommittee will consider all the completed audit reports once they're finalised. Pages 106 to 108 confirms financial processes performance has remained strong. And finally, members are asked to approve the utilisation of the £650,000 revenue saving to increase the capital investment reserve. I'm happy to take any questions on the financial review report. Okay,
thanks. Any questions or comments?
Item 5 is the authority's budget for the 2017. Just to say on this, we've already had quite a lot of information regarding the budget setting process, and part of the budget today we agreed last year on the 2-year budget that we've put forward. We also had the members' strategy today where we went through all the options available and we'll have the up to date position as regards to finances.
Thanks, Chair. I'll try and be brief. The budget report presented to the authority provides the necessary financial information for members to approve a financial strategy that sets a balanced 2016-17 revenue budget and precept level in line with statutory requirements, and subject to all the financial assumptions remaining robust, deliver a balanced financial plan up to and including 2019-20. The report sets out on paragraph 51 to 74, page 150 to 155, the proposed 5-year capital programme and prudential borrowing requirements. And as per the table on page 151, the total programme provides for investments of just over £38 million, of which around £22 million has been funded by prudential borrowing. New schemes totalling around £4.7 million have been added, but most of this relates to the addition of the rolling extra year 2020-21. Paragraph 75 to 84 on page 156 to 157 outline how the minimum revenue provision, which is the sum that will be set aside each year to repay outstanding historic and future debt associated with capital expenditure, will be determined. Paragraph 85 to 94, pages 158 to 160, outline the impact of the proposed capital investment over a number of predetermined prudential indicators to determine its affordability and sustainability. The proposed capital investment costs have all been built into the financial plan and are therefore sustainable and affordable. Paragraphs 95 to 97, pages 161 to 169, outline the authority's treasury management strategy. The proposed investment strategy is consistent with the current strategy and recommends continuing with the current institutional limits and minimum credit ratings, and the proposed authorised limit for debt will ensure that the total gross debt does not exceed the capital financing requirement, and hence all borrowing is only incurred to cover capital investment. So sections C2F, which is one through, in the report outline all costs associated with the proposed capital programme and prudential borrowing have been built into the proposed medium-term financial plan and are deemed to be sustainable and affordable. The report then goes out to set out on paragraph 98 to 124, pages 170 to 175, the existing financial plan and assumptions and any known changes. And as per table, the table on page 172, the existing plan assumed a £14.1 million saving requirement by 2019-20 before any announcements of the actual government grant settlement for 16-17 and future years. As outlined on page 175, paragraph 123, the £14.1 million anticipated challenge reduced to £11 million following the announcements of the 2016-17-19-20 grant settlement. After taking into account the impact of the £1 million 2016-17 council tax base increase, this has left the authority with a forecast £10 million challenge to deliver as outlined on the table on page 175. Paragraphs 125 to 159 on pages 176 to 185 identifies the possible saving options for the authority to consider in order to deliver the remaining £10 million saving challenge. The table on page 181 summarises the technical and non-employee savings being put forward, totalling £4.5 million. Assuming members support these proposals, this leaves £5.5 million to be found in employee costs. Members have already approved a reduction in senior management costs of £0.5 million. Therefore, the technical and non-employee and senior management saving proposals will, if approved, allow the authority time to develop the detailed proposals to deliver the remaining £5 million employee savings during 16-17. Paragraphs 144 to 145 on page 182 outline a proposal for the Chief Fire Officer to review the and support functions and reduce non-firefighter posts by up to a further 15% or £1 million by the end of 2017-18 at the latest. This would leave a balance of £4 million to come from operational response, which equates to about 100 firefighter posts and potentially the loss of four whole-time fire appliances. Paragraphs 146 to 156 on pages 182 to 184 outline the operational response challenges and priorities identified by the Chief Fire Officer. Work has commenced on evaluating all the potential operational response models that deliver the required reduction of firefighter posts, and the Chief Fire Officer will consult with the public on possible options as part of the IRMP 2017-20 consultation process. The Chief Fire Officer will bring back the recommendation to members on the future operational structure with delivery required budget savings for approval during 2016-17. And as outlined in paragraphs 146 to 156, pages 182 to 184, the reduction in firefighter posts will be phased to reflect the future firefighter retirement profile, and the reduction is unlikely to be fully delivered until towards the end of 2018-19. As outlined in Appendix C, the saving proposals, if approved, would deliver the required £11 million savings by 2019-20 and a balanced 2016-17 revenue budget and financial plan. Pages 186 to 189 identify the anticipated reserves over the financial plan period and recommends that the authority maintain the general fund reserve at the current level of £2 million. And finally, pages 190 to 191 identifies that £25.9 million needs to be raised from the council tax preset in 2016-17 to balance the revenue budget. And that equates to a Band D council tax preset demand of £72.89, an increase of 1.99% on the 2015-16 figure of £71.47. Members are asked to approve the report recommendations 2A through to 2K, and I'm happy to take any questions on that board.
Okay, just before we open up the questions, I'll ask the Chief just to go through what this means to the operational side of the research.
Thanks, Chair. As we've discussed previously, the strategy thing, as Ian has just outlined there is a requirement to deliver £4 million of savings over the next 4 years from operational response. Paragraph 153 of the report on page 184 sets out, if you like, the two extremes by which we might do that. We explain those in detail on the strategy deck. So that is something that we will work on over the course of the next year and bring to members in October. Is as part of the draft integrated risk management plan for 2017 through to 2020. What we can say for this year, members, if you are minded to approve the budget recommendation and the resolution that you've been asked to consider today, what it will mean is that we do not require to make any structural changes in this next financial year, 2016-17. Instead, we will take the managerial savings, which in truth we have already delivered. What that would allow us, as you'll be able to see on the chart on page 183, what that then allows is for the firefighter retirements to actually start to catch up with where we are in terms of the financial savings. So that would buy us a full year of not having to reduce any firefighter posts. So I am strongly recommending what the Treasurer has just outlined to you there. That gives us a year then to work up an integrated risk management plan, which details how we need to deliver the balance of the firefighter post reductions in a way which is least impacting as we achieve. So I just thought it was important to make that point to members. If you approve this budget resolution today, it will be the first time, certainly in the late November, that we won't actually be reducing the firefighter establishment in year.
Thank you. Okay, I'll open up now to any comments or questions from members. Anybody wishes to make any comments?
Can I just make a comment? I don't think anybody in this room, either the top two, any of us got involved in politics or whatever to make these kind of cuts. It's a shame that we're here today, and it's with a very, very heavy heart we have to do to the Merseyside service. It's absolutely appalling. But I would like to thank the officers at the same time, the way they have gone down the route of telling everybody just what is going on, very open and above, down to the strategy day where we're just with the red bodies, with the finance officers from our own authorities. You should hold your head in good esteem, because no authority I know would go down the route you've gone. You've got to the combined authority, told the leaders that Merseyside what's going on, and you've also been to all the local MPs. So you've done a grand job. It's with a very, very heavy heart that we have to move this today and move the recommendations.
Part of the process, obviously, everybody should have received a copy of the draft budget resolution. We don't have any amendments to that, so that's then with the storm and move the resolution. I'll second that. I'll just ask, because we, as the chair and vice chairs, we're mindful to make sure that we fully understand.
seeing a reverse in the number of fire deaths, unfortunately, but they're associated in any way to the austerity measures, only time will tell. But obviously one fire death is one fire death too many. Now unfortunately, we had 10 last year, I think the total so far this year is 13. You know, we got down to a position where we had 5, you know, which is what we want. That's our job, that's our duty, that's our responsibility, that's our goal. So obviously the work that we were undertaking had a positive effect. But now we see it going in the opposite direction. It's a message to this government that they should now sit up and listen to the concerns of the fire and rescue service. We are a statutory body. We are an emergency service. We do respond to risk. When you're cutting our budgets, it does have a detrimental impact on how we deliver our service. And as we go forward this year and up until 2020, we will see yet further cuts to our service, further cuts to the delivery of our service and the breakup of our service. You know, at one time, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service had over 1,500 firefighters. Today we have 664. Next year we'll have 564, and that may go even lower. When you think about the county across Merseyside, we have 1.4 million people, and we end up with about 500 firefighters trying to address some of the problems and incidents that we have to face on a daily basis. And some of the additional work that we have is on the health and wellbeing agenda, and work with our colleagues from police and the ambulance service. You know, we're doing all we can, and everything that the government has asked us to do, we are carrying out to the letter, if not more. And we're quite happy to engage with our emergency service colleagues, and you know, that will continue, that work will continue. But you have to look and examine about the impact that the cuts are having on our ability to deliver the service. If we have a major incident with Merseyside, are we in a position to cope with it? We send people to other areas like sad case of Dick Cock. You know, we went to Bosley, we went and helped with floods in Cumbria, Lancashire, Yorkshire. You know, we're always there to help. And we've proven time and time again that this service is very effective and very efficient. Our bonuses have given us a clean bill of health, probably one of the best acceptance of the way we deal with things in any part of local government, as it was, not part of the Home Office. But now that we are part of the Home Office, we need to say to these ministers, we are the only emergency services that has no protection. And that cannot continue. It cannot continue. We need to ensure that they act on the cuts that they've implemented, not only in Merseyside, but the other core cities, to ensure that we are in a better place to respond to any incident, any emergency. And we can do that response with confidence, with certainty, and that we're not just going on a recovery basis, but we're going to try and rescue people and try and save lives. So I won't go on any longer. Just as we ask the budget, unfortunately we will have to increase the council tax elements of our preset to the local authorities by just 1-2%. And obviously the impact that this will have on our communities, because I'm sure all of the five district councils will be increasing their council tax bills and our part of it, but we are a very much value for money service, and long may that continue. Yes,
thank you, Chair. Echo what we said. I think we should also thank all the members of our own fire authority. Over this past year, they've all had in their own authorities a difficult time to be advocates for this service. I think that we are on the cusp of a change. We've moved department to the Home Office. There's never been an investigation, there's never been a sort of a test of the cuts and changes that have been made. Maybe they'll take that on board. We're looking at the involvement of the PCCs and the County MERS. We're in a position of considerable change. We've not exactly a breathing space, but this budget enables us to actually have a platform to move on from here for the next 4 years. But what we need to do is to lobby those other politicians in our own districts. We've got the great support of our members of Parliament who helped us by calling a debate in Westminster Chamber a couple of weeks ago. Bye-bye. And we have the chance now to continue to make the case for our firefighters and for all those of our staff who do great work to keep the people of Merseyside safe. And there's many of our colleagues around us who perhaps don't completely understand the work that we do, and it's our continued role, and ever should be the role, and hopefully we'll continue to have a role, even under the combined authority, as representatives from the districts, to be able to put the case for what our staff, advocates, both those on, in the fire stations and in our fire headquarters do. Thank you for all that they have done, and let's hope that we can continue to make a very strong case.
Thank you.
So we need to remove the budget. We need to do this by a show of hands. So all those in favour of the budget? I've got to say this one. Anybody against? Just for the record, which is good. So that's a unanimous decision from the from our authority, which is good to have all party support. But just as to say that we will continue to lobby our politicians. Civil servants and press upon them as best we can about the impact of these cuts are having on our duty, our statutory duty to respond to emergencies. Just to inform members that we've actually got a meeting with the Shadow Home Secretary tomorrow morning, Andy Bairn, to discuss with him not only the transfer from the DCRD to the Home Office, but also what the future holds for the direction of travel for the fire service in the future, and obviously present to him the impact of the cuts to ourselves. And how we're going to face them over the next couple of years, as where we'll be by 2020, what the service will look like, and the need for help, for assistance from as his position as the Shadow Home Secretary, to call upon the government to have a full risk assessment and analysis of the cuts to the fire and rescue service. So we'll make those comments tomorrow at our meeting. But thank you all very much for supporting the budget today. I know it's difficult, but we understand the reasons why. Okay, if we move on to item 6, which is the emergency medical response trial.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to provide a further update to members beyond that, which I gave when I spoke to the industry relations update report at the last authority meeting, which was held on the 17th of December. As members will recall, the authority had submitted an application to the National Joint Council to take part in the emergency medical response trial, which is one of five national work streams that's currently being pursued. This trial will involve firefighters responding to incidents of cardiac arrest as part of the North West Ambulance Service's predetermined attendance. A memorandum of understanding was signed last week with North West Ambulance Service and the representative bodies, which will see the commencement of the trial here on Merseyside with effect from this coming Monday, 29th of February. A copy of the MOU is attached to the report at Appendix B. The commencement of the trial will be launched by the Deputy Chief Fire Officer and the Interim Chief Executive of North West Ambulance Service at an event at Southport Community Fire and Ambulance Station on Monday morning. Southport, Wallasey and Speak will commence the trial, and discussions are ongoing over how that trial might be extended across all stations on Merseyside. But just draw members' attention to paragraphs 13 to 17 on the report at pages 6 to 15. You'll note that the analysis undertaken of the last 3 years' worth of data of what is termed a grade 1 incident, so that falls, that's the cardiac arrest incident, indicates that we responded to every single grade 1 call that North West Ambulance Service received. And across Merseyside, we would mobilise to an additional 7 incidents each day. Bear in mind that if we responded to every single one of the grade 1 calls. That would result in a slight increase in our average response times and a slight reduction of 1.4% in our attainment of the 10-minute response standard. That said, members, I'm still very much of the belief that the benefits of this trial far outweigh any risk. To reassure members, there are a number of safeguards that are built in to account for any high levels of fire and rescue service activity, which are primarily that our fire control can decline a response in such circumstances. There are a number of other issues which are captured within the report, but I'm not going to speak to them in any great detail because I'm conscious of the fact that I've already recently given you an update on the AMRSR at the last authority meeting. I am, however, happy to take any questions, Chair.
Any questions, comments or observations?
Just one quick one, Chair. On the operational side, if the red one happens, will both the fire authority and the ambulance service be notified and they'll both go out at the same time? And in reality, are we getting a situation where the authority then, or the fire authority then be able to move off once the ambulance gets there? It's ready to do that first couple of minutes when it's really important that someone is there. Is that how it's going to work, Chief?
Yeah, just to reassure Councillor Garton, we form part of the long-term attendance. So irrespective of whether we attend or we don't, North West Ambulance Service clearly respond to these incidents as a priority. So I suppose the substantive point to make here is we don't stop the clock. So if we arrive first, that doesn't stop the clock. North West Ambulance Service still have to attend within 8 minutes. So we are there to support the response. We are not the primary response, just to evacuate the issue.
Yeah, so really, it's just that we're lucky enough to get there 2 minutes before them. That's a difference between life and death on many occasions.
Awesome.
That could be. Thank
awesome.
You.
Any other comments?
Okay.
We have to approve the report. Any comments on the report? Go on to item 7 now, we'll need to exclude the present public. We'll start the discussion now, so
I'll be right back.
I think that's an old one. I've got an old one.